When you hear the word raptor, what comes to mind first? Is it today's predatory birds? Or maybe you think of a scaly monster with hyperintelligence. Well, what if I could help you paint a different picture for your imagination? This week, I wanted to discuss one of my favorite kinds of dinosaurs. This is an animal that many fans are familiar with, but they may not know too much about them. So, what is a raptor? They are theropod dinosaurs under the dromaeosaur family. The term raptor comes from Latin meaning thief or abductor. This word conjures images of swift animals like hawks or eagles. In 1964, a remarkable find was made in Montana, which would kickstart the beginning of what later became known as the dinosaur renaissance. The bones of a bipedal meat-eating dinosaur were discovered, but it was unlike anything paleontologists had seen before. This wasn't a sluggish lizard, but a nimble and lithe creature with a very active lifestyle. A dig team led by Professor John Ostrom, who I can make an entire video just on him alone, were prospecting for fossils when a claw was spotted sticking out from the ground. They found a hand with three long fingers tipped with eagle-like talons. They also found sections of the tail, where the vertebrae appeared to have been held in place by longitudinal rows of stiffened, rod-like tendons. This would give it a rigid tail, which was odd since at this time larger dinosaurs were more or less depicted as scaly kangaroos. More curious was the toes and a foot, but one of the toe claws was substantially larger than the others. Ostrom published his findings in 1969, naming the animal Deinonychus, or Terrible Claw. The first recorded Deinonychus to have been found actually came from Barnum Brown in the 1930s, but he had never published his findings. This specimen was thought to have been an agile pursuit predator due to its lean look and was easily recognized by the community due to its large sickle-shaped claw on either foot. In Ostrom's own words, Deinonychus certainly opened up a whole new window in viewing these animals. This animal clearly indicated extreme agility, activity, perhaps even intelligence. But these were very, very sophisticated animals, unlike our previous image of what dinosaurs were about. Perceptions of dinosaurs had been regarded as slow and stupid since the 1820s. Now, well over 100 years later, paleontologists were forced to rethink pretty much everything that they thought they knew. Some of these old dinosaur reconstructions look pretty odd to us nowadays since we recognize them as being much more bird-like in modern paleontology. Back in the 19th century, British naturalist Thomas Huxley had proposed that dinosaurs and birds shared common ancestry. You might recognize Huxley's name from your middle school history book. He was given the nickname Darwin's Bulldog for aggressively advocating Charles Darwin's theory of evolution. Ostrom used this theory for a radical idea. Birds were directly descended from dinosaurs. In 1970, he visited a museum in the Netherlands to examine a pterosaur fossil. Surprise, surprise! It wasn't a pterosaur at all, but a misidentified feathered theropod. He immediately recognized the similarities between this specimen and raptors. This would later be named Archaeopteryx, or better known informally as the first bird. In 1976, Ostrom published his paper on Archaeopteryx and the origin of birds. Here he reviewed over 200 anatomical similarities that birds shared with theropod dinosaurs. Archaeopteryx is an incredible example of a transitional species. It had avian characteristics like feathers and wings, but it also had reptilian features like teeth and a long bony tail. While Archaeopteryx is not a technical raptor in a phylogenetic sense, and the exact branching is still debated, they are so closely related on the family tree that we can pretty confidently say that most theropod dinosaurs, if not all of them, would have had some kind of a feather integument. But there are specimens of raptors with direct evidence of feathers. Microraptor was a very small dromaeosaur from China during the Cretaceous period. Adult specimens are estimated to be up to 77 centimeters long, or about 2.5 feet. Well-preserved fossils of this raptor provide important evidence about the relationship to birds. There are a number of different feathers that modern birds have today. Some of these are for insulation to keep warm, while others are meant for flight. The ones that are useful for flight are known as pinnaceous feathers, and these are exactly what Microraptor had. These feathers were long on both of its arms, but even on its legs. They also had a beautifully shaped fan on the end of the tail. In comparison to modern birds, they were most likely not the most efficient flyers. Most birds today don't have particularly long tail feathers, as this creates drag and is honestly not very aerodynamic. At the very least, they would have been excellent gliders in their forest homes. Numerous studies have been done to try and determine exactly how it would have flown. One particular study comes from the University of Southampton in England. They built a 3-foot model and tested the wing capabilities in a wind tunnel. Tests showed that high lifts of the tail fan would have produced stability while gliding, allowing for slow gliding without losing too much height. The dinosaur could glide further with their legs hanging down below the level of their front wings, rather than having all four limbs sprawled out in a large X position. So maybe it couldn't fly the same way modern birds do, but wow, this is just such a find. I am so happy that Microraptor existed. Okay, so we've taken a look at one of the smaller raptors, but what's the biggest one? That would be none other than the frightening and amazing Utah raptor. The largest one to have ever been found measures at a whopping 23 feet long and about 5 feet tall at just the hip. This animal was massive, and that cannot be overstated. The curved claw on each of its hind feet were nearly a foot long. While no direct evidence of feathers have been found for Utah raptor, we can once again infer from its relatives that it is highly likely that they were either partially or fully covered in feathers. I hear a lot of debate online as to whether dinosaurs having feathers makes them not as cool or scary, but in all honesty, getting eaten alive by a giant feathered bird frightens me more than an overgrown lizard. Plus, plenty of birds show aggression to people even today. I can't imagine how I'd react to seeing a giant swan with teeth and claws coming after me. And finally, the raptor you have all been waiting for me to talk about. I, of course, mean none other than Velociraptor. Yep. This is the real Velociraptor. They're kind of cute, aren't they? Most are about 6 feet in length and probably weighed as much as a small to medium-sized dog. In 2007, researchers found quill knobs on the forearm of a specimen from Mongolia. These bumps on birdwing bones show where feathers anchor. Their presence on Velociraptor indicate that it too must have had feathers. As many scientists in the paleo community today would say, a velociraptor without feathers isn't a velociraptor. If you were to see a velociraptor alive and well today, you would most likely just think they looked like odd ground-dwelling falcons. There were so many more raptors that I wanted to discuss today, like Bambi Raptor, Pyroraptor, and Atrociraptor, but I don't want this video to be too long, so I think I'll need to save those for a future upload. I also think I want to make a follow-up video to this one talking about some misconceptions around dromaeosaurs, so please let me know what you guys would be most interested in hearing about. Thank you guys for watching this week's video. I'd love to know if you maybe have a favorite raptor I didn't talk about. Feel free to comment down below and maybe consider giving this video a like if you learned anything new. Thanks so much again for watching this, and I'll see you guys next time!